Thank you. It is now time for a question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Premier, as leaders, we're judged by the decisions that we make and the standards we set for those around us. As Premier, that sends a signal to job creators and investors about what it's like to do business in the province of Ontario. And for those who are desperate to get a steady job, they look to the Premier for leadership. I've asked you day in and day out. I've suggested extending the sitting for at least an additional week so you go with the jobs plan. You've decided not to do that. But I also want to talk about the...
I will have order today. Leader.
But this is more so on the standards that you
member from Sudbury will come to order.
That Auditor General's report last night should keep you asleep at night. The grotesque waste in our hydro system. This is about your leadership and your standards. After that kind of abuse, no wonder hydro bills are going through. I just got to ask you, what's going to happen to your
Minister
energy?
Minister of Rural Affairs will come to order. Question.
Watch. How can you set that standard? Where is the bar? What's going to happen to Bob Chiarelli after this incredible mess at Ontario Power Generation?
My desire for quiet is for all of the House. I would ask the remind the Leader of the Opposition to use either titles or writings, and that goes for anyone that decides to interject. I will be strong on that issue today. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, and first of all, I want to thank the Auditor General for her report. I think it's a very important part of our system, Mr. Speaker, that we have the oversight and that we have the analysis of government organization, and the Auditor General has done a very good job, Mr. Speaker, and the OPG and the government take very seriously the findings that she has outlined. As the Leader of the Opposition knows, when we learned of the Auditor's findings, we expressed our concern to the OPG's Board Chair and CEO. We informed OPG that a plan of action had to be implemented to correct all the issues that have been identified in the report, Mr. Speaker. It's clear that Ontarians should expect better and can expect better. The board has terminated the employment of its chief financial officer, the executive vice president, strategic initiatives, and vice president, internal audit. OPG will reduce the eligible amount performance pay of all.
Thank you. Supplementary?
No, I mean, very respectfully, hold on a second here. This report you would have had in your possession 4 months. The energy minister has been there for 10. These jobs don't pop up like mushrooms in the dark. These are 8,000. These are jaw-dropping figures. 8,000 people making $100,000 a year more on the hydro system. 60% of the workforce are in middle and upper management. It just makes no sense to those people who are struggling to pay their hydro bills to see this kind of scandalous mess. And the only time you react is when you see it as issues management. Once the horse is out of the barn, once the report comes out, you got to respond to the newspapers, and he makes something up. Why wasn't something done sooner? 8,000 jobs don't pop up overnight. I mean, was he asleep at the switch? This is the guy that famously said, oh, don't worry about the gas plants. It's all just a cup of Tim Hortons coffee. And his own Marie Antoinette moment last week. Premier, the standards you set send a signal to investors and job creators about who's in charge. So let me ask you, who's in charge?
Answer.
What do you do to
your
hydro minister for the incredible mess that Ontario Power Generation?
Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, well, we have taken action, and I know that the Minister of Energy will want to speak to the specifics. But, Mr. Speaker, let me be clear. There has not been a government, Mr. Speaker, in Ontario that has had the controls that I believe need to be in place, the controls over compensation, Mr. Speaker, in this agency. There has not been a government that has put those controls in place. Not the government, the party opposite, Mr. Speaker, not the third party. We are putting those controls in place. It is very important to me that Ontarians can expect better, Mr. Speaker, and the culture that has developed over subsequent decades, Mr. Speaker.
Stop the clock, please. The member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke will come to order. The member from Northumberland, Quinty West, will come to order. And the Minister for Rural Affairs will come to order when she's answering. Please.
Mr. Speaker, the challenges with the energy sector compensation existed when the Leader of Opposition's party was in government, Mr. Speaker. He didn't change it. He was in cabinet. His leader didn't change it, Mr. Speaker. I'm not making excuses for the behaviour. What I'm saying is we are changing it.
Thank you. Stop the clock, please. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Start the clock. Final supplementary. The Grenville will come to order.
Honest to God, Speaker, only the Liberals would give this kind of incredible waste a standing ovation. You've been there for 10 years. And again, Premier, this is about the standard that you set for your leadership team. How can they get confidence in the province? This energy is one of the most crucial ministries when it comes to job creation. And it's a scandalous mess, and it's costing us jobs, like Kellogg's, like John Deere. Your health minister, similarly, is failing a very crucial test. I just find it absolutely—I'm incredulous that the health minister didn't know that Chris Mazza had a $10 million salary coming in his way. She said she left it sealed in the report. I actually find that hard to believe. I think probably it's easier to say that than to say that she didn't act. Either way, it's inexcusable. Energy is critical to jobs and investment. Health is critical to our most vulnerable populations. If you see this kind of happening, I know you're close. I know you're
Question.
Friends. But that's not what decisions should be about. It should be about competence, who's doing the best and watching up for taxpayers in the province of Ontario. What are the standards you have for your ministers when you see this type of scandal and you're looking the other way?
Thank you.
No question.
You see it, please? You see it, please? Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And, you know, I'm not surprised that the Leader of the Opposition would want to move off energy, because he knows full well that government after government has not taken action in terms of making sure that government has the mechanisms and has the levers to pull, Mr. Speaker, to take control over those compensation packages. We are taking that action, Mr. Speaker. In terms of responsibility and taking action, Mr. Speaker, every situation that the Leader of the Opposition has spoken to, we have dealt with, Mr. Speaker, we have learned from those situations, and we have put in place a new regime, Mr. Speaker, whether it's in the specific situations in health care or whether it's in energy, Mr. Speaker. But the Leader of the Opposition needs to accept that the culture that he is talking about
Answer.
In the energy organization, Mr.
The
Speaker,
from the
is one that has been in place
order.
For decades.
New question. The member from Newmarket Aurora.
My question is to the Premier. The Health Minister this morning, when asked what the budget is of Orange and whether she knows what the annual payments are for the $275 million bond offering, responded by saying, "Is this a quiz?" Speaker, it's actually very serious business. I want to know from the Premier, does she think it's acceptable for her health minister not to know what the annual budget of Orange is and not to know about a $20 million annual payment that Orange now has to make on a $275 million
Question.
Bond offering? Is that the kind of competency and transparency and oversight that she expects
Thank you.
From her health minister?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, you know, Mr. Speaker, the member opposite has been a member, minister of the Crown. He knows what's entailed in doing that job, Mr. Speaker. He has not been the Minister of Health, which is a $48 billion ministry, Mr. Speaker, so he actually doesn't understand what it takes to transform a system like that. He actually doesn't understand what's necessary in terms of the ability to evaluate evidence and to understand.
The Minister of the Environment will come to order. The member from Cambridge will come to order.
Mr. Speaker, what I think he does know is that the Minister of Health, that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care has a responsibility to make sure that we have a health care system that is sustainable over the long term. And in order to do that, Mr. Speaker, we have to make changes.
And
those are the kinds of changes that this Minister of Health is making so that the member opposite's children and grandchildren who live in Ontario will have a health care system when they need it.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, I think the first change that should be made is a change for the Minister of Health, because for the Minister of Health not to even know what the annual budget of Orange is, this is an agency, an organization that has been under the scope of the public, of a public accounts committee for 2.5 years. One would expect that at the very least she would know what's going on in that agency, but she doesn't. And so I'm asking the Premier one more time to transform the health ministry of the province of Ontario. How can she count on a minister who doesn't know the fundamental issues relating to Orange? How can she expect that minister to do her job when she demonstrates that kind of incompetence every day, every hour of the year? How can she possibly expect transformation to happen?
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier. Edward Hastings will come to order. Carry on.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Because the fundamental issue that this Minister of Health and Long-Term Care had to deal with was to make sure that the changes were in place so that there would be the appropriate oversight at Orange, Mr. Speaker. That's why we reintroduced Bill 11, Mr. Speaker. Orange is more accountable, that there is a system in place that makes sure that the correct monitoring is there so that that situation won't arise again. That's the fundamental, Mr. Speaker. That's the policy issue that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care is responsible for, and that's the policy issue that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care is dealing with. That's why she reintroduced Bill 11, Mr. Speaker, and the member opposite knows full well that it's support for that kind of oversight that he should be putting forward, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
Well, Speaker, it's interesting that that bill has not been called back for the legislature to deal with. Why not? There's been lots of time. We haven't seen this bill in this House if that bill is so important. Again, why isn't the Minister of Health doing her job? Why isn't that bill in the House for debate? Why hasn't that bill been passed if, in fact, it's going to make the difference? I'm going to ask the Premier to refer this question to the Minister of Health. Can the Minister of Health tell us if, between the public accounts hearing this morning and now, has she found out what the budget of Orange is for this fiscal year? Can the minister tell us?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I believe that the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care gave the number. She said $152 million in committee, Mr. Speaker. My understanding, if you check Hansard, I think you will find the number there. But, Mr. Speaker, you know, the member opposite talks about bringing a particular bill forward. What he doesn't talk about, Mr. Speaker, is that the procedural games that are being played in the legislature, Mr. Speaker, it's very difficult. It's very difficult from the outside to look at what's happening with in-house leaders' meetings and across the floor. But the reality is, Mr. Speaker, that there is procedural wrangling that's going on. It's very unfortunate. We are working very hard to make the minority parliament work, Mr. Speaker. It would be fabulous to have two partners in that, in the opposition and the third party.
Thank you. Your question, the leader of the third party.
Thank you
Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Last March, the Sunshine List showed hydro executives receiving massive compensation that broke the million-dollar mark by a mile. Did the Premier bother to even look at that Sunshine List, Speaker?
Thank you, Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And as I have said many times in this House, we are introducing legislation. We are acting on our commitment to put controls in place on executive compensation, Mr. Speaker. But we are going to do it in such a way that recognizes the complexity of the various sectors, that recognizes that there need to be ranges in place, including hard caps, Mr. Speaker, and recognizes that we have to look at the total compensation packages. And as I have said, subsequent governments have not put in place the mechanisms and levers to make sure that government has the control over those compensation packages. And I'm not talking about a 10-year situation, Mr. Speaker. I'm talking about decades, tens of years, Mr. Speaker, where those controls have not been in place. The government, the parties opposite did not make those changes. We are, Mr.
Answer,
Speaker,
the
we
member
will put
from
those
Bruce
controls
Gray
in place.
Sound will come to order. Go supplementary.
Speaker, while most people were reacting with shock to those reports of sky-high salaries last March, the Premier mused about raising the reporting threshold. And there's not any evidence that she did much else, Speaker. Did she call the head of the OPG or any hydro agency to ask on behalf of ratepayers what was going on with these sky-high salaries?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The very point that I've been making is that government after government has not put the controls in place to be able to ask those questions and get that information, Mr. Speaker. And I'm not excusing that, but I'm saying that there is a culture that developed that needs to be changed. Government after government did not make that change. I've been in this office since February, Mr. Speaker. We're going to make that change so government will be able to have direct control over those compensation packages.
Final supplementary.
Speaker, may I remind the Premier that for 10 years there has been a Liberal in the Premier's office and a Liberal at the Ministry of Energy. The OPG has one shareholder, Speaker. It's the province. The Premier's job is to be a voice for the people who are paying high, sky-high electricity bills. That's part of her job. People have watched the salaries and the perks grow for years. Is she telling the people paying the bills that she didn't place a single call to find out what the heck was going on?
Mr. Speaker, the Auditor General's report was over a period of 10 years. And it's important to note, Mr. Speaker, that in 2007, in response to the Agency Review Panel report,
order.
The Ministry reduced OPG's executive salaries by 25% to 30% for new executive contracts. It couldn't change existing contracts. In addition, OPG executive compensation envelope has decreased by 9% since 2010 and is continuing to replace exiting executives at a lower cost. Base pay for OPG executives, including vice presidents, has been frozen since 2010 and continues to be frozen. And, Mr. Speaker, through their business transformation plan between 2011 and 2015,
answer.
There will be a reduction of 2,300 full-time employees, with 1,500 FTEs already happening, Mr. Speaker.
Wow. New question, Leader of the Third Party.
My next question is also for the Premier, Speaker. OPG is owned by the people of Ontario. It's the job of the Premier to speak up on behalf of people paying the highest electricity bills in Canada. Instead, the Premier defended the same old policies. People have watched year after year as CEO salaries grew and grew and grew.
Minister of Trade, College Universities, come to order.
She just chose to absolutely do nothing about it. Is she ready to admit that once again the Liberals completely ignored their responsibility to the people who are stuck paying the bills in this province?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, the premise and the substance of the Leader of the Third Party's question is just not accurate, Mr. Speaker. As the Minister of Energy has just outlined, there have been actions taken. But as I have said, I believe that there need to be more controls, there needs to be more authority on the part of government in order to take control of those compensation packages, Mr. Speaker. And from my perspective, this is an issue that has developed over decades, not over the the last 10 years, Mr. Speaker, but over decades. And that means that there have been subsequent governments, Mr. Speaker, that have not taken action. And we have taken action. There have been changes made. But the fact is there's more that needs to be done. That's why we're going to change it. That's why we're going to put controls in place so that government will have more direct control over those compensation packages. And I would expect that the leader of the third party would support that change, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, while the Premier and her party were letting OPG executive pay skyrocket and helping executives buy million-dollar homes, people have been watching their bills go up to pay for the sky-high pay and perks. Ron from the Niagara region writes this, Speaker, and I quote, "I live in an apartment which is heated with electric heat. My old age security and Canada Pension Plan have increased by less than 1%. The government has no concept of what their hydro increases do to the average senior. The management system in hydro is so far away from the reality others live under." End quote. What does the Premier have to say to folks like Ron, Speaker?
Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, there are pressure on prices, but however, when it comes to the Ontario power generation, Mr. Speaker, they have received no rate increase since 2008. 2011, Mr. Speaker, they made an application for an increase of 6.4%. The Ontario Energy Board gave them a reduction of 0.8%. So, Mr. Speaker, the Ontario power generation produces 40% of the power in Ontario, and their rate base is less than the other 60%, Mr. Speaker. In addition, Mr. Speaker, over the course of the last 8 years, they have generated $7 billion in net transfers dollars to the province of Ontario to help pay for schools, hospitals, and colleges, Mr. Speaker.
Answer, thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, Ontario families are paying the highest electricity bills in Canada. And instead of taking action, the Premier has turned a blind eye. People are tired of being stuck with sky-high bills because the Liberals simply can't be bothered to give a damn. New Democrats have been calling for a hard cap on CEO salaries for years, Speaker. Is this Premier ready to admit that the Liberal government is responsible for driving up the hydro bills that people in this province are paying?
Minister of Energy.
Is the leader of the third party, Mr. Speaker, prepared to accept the fact that she has no plan for hydro rates in the province of Ontario? She has no policy with respect to renewables. She's refusing to say yes to not going ahead with nuclear, Mr. Speaker. And in speaking of nuclear, Mr. Speaker, we have taken some very significant steps to moderate rate increases for the next 20 years. That includes, Mr. Speaker, deferring new
member
nuclear,
from Chatham,
which the leader
Essex,
of the opposition, Mr. Speaker, would invest $15 billion on hydro that we don't need, Mr. Speaker. We have a 20-year plan, Mr. Speaker. It projects an increase of 2.8% over that period, Mr. Speaker, and for the short number of years leading into that 20 years, Mr. Speaker, we have created mitigating programs for energy consumers, Mr. Speaker, including the 10% discount, including the energy tax credit, including the seniors' energy credit, Mr. Speaker.
Your question, the member from the Peel Carlton.
Speaker, my pleasure to rise on behalf of the Ontario PC Caucus today to ask a question of the Premier regarding OPG. Speaker, obviously, the OPG has just made the Senate of Canada look like good stewards of the taxpayers' dollars. And here we are today, and I have so much material, Speaker, and questions I don't know which to ask. The first I might ask the Premier is, how could she let handsome pension plans like those that are occurring at the OPG still continue? Another question I might ask the Premier today is, how could she only fire three executives when the rot and the corruption at OPG has gone so deep into that organization? I could also ask her how she could allow nepotism to occur to the level that it has at the OPG. But, Speaker, I won't. The question I am going to ask is on behalf of the Ottawa Council of Business Improvement Areas. 19 business improvement areas in the City of Ottawa have asked the Premier this question. We urge you to please consider and work on the side of Ottawa retailers and job creators, on the side of Ottawa employees, and reconsider your crippling hydro increases. Will you,
thank you,
do it?
Thank you. Stop the clock, please. Receive it, please. Receive it, please. Thank you, Premier.
Mr. Speaker, when the Leader of the Opposition was asked if he would freeze or lower rates, he said, no, I cannot do that, Mr. Speaker. That's for starters. But let's talk about his policy with respect to the Ontario Power Generation. His policy, Mr. Speaker, is...
I've got them up here. Carry on.
He would privatize Ontario Power Generation, Mr.
Yes.
Speaker. And the Toronto Sun, Mr. Speaker, floated.
The member from Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke, come to order. The member from Leeds, Granville, come to order.
Electricity generation.
Last time.
It would lead to lower hydro rates. Instead, it led to exactly the opposite.
Wow.
Rates skyrocketed amid rampant Tory pet patronage, and the Conservatives faced with rising public fury, abandoned the scheme, leaving a financial disaster in their wake. His policy is to privatize, to try to do what he did last time, and that's
Thank
what
you.
His Toronto Sun says about his policy.
Thank you. You see the first supplementary.
This minister has a lot of nerve on a day after what was, I think, the most damning Auditor General's report since I have been in this chamber in three terms to stand in his place and talk about a public policy initiative a decade ago, before his government was in office, before the taxpayers of this province were paying for their boondoggles.
Order. The Minister of Energy will come to order. Thunder Bay Atikokan can come to order. Finish, please.
Let's just stick with the facts, Premier, Minister, government over there. The people of this province are stuck with your energy policies. Last week it was the long-term energy plan, which is driving up rates. The week before that it was the $1.1 billion gas scandal. This week it's the OPG, the new Senate of Canada, who is wasting taxpayer dollars and hurting the ratepayers of this province. My question is, will he listen to the ratepayers in our city, the Ottawa Business Improvement Council? Will you listen to them, and will you scrap your long-term energy plan, and will you put OPG in his place and fire more than three people?
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Speaker, first of all, to correct the record, the policy that I referred to was not 10 years ago. It was his white paper that he issued about 12 months ago.
Oh, the white paper.
There, Mr. Speaker. The Tories' failed attempt to privatize the electricity system in the late 1990s led to a sudden price shock. In only a few months, the price increased by 30%.
Wow.
And it gets worse. Tim's, the Leader of the Opposition's proposal, could mean that OPG would have to sell off Niagara Falls Generating Station, one of Ontario's greatest assets. The last time they tried to privatize, top advisors were at the trough. Well-connected Tory insiders received nearly $6 million in untendered contracts from Hydro One. That's the National Post, Mr. Speaker. Tom Long, this leader's co-campaign manager, made off with $1.3 million in Hydro One contracts. Toronto Star, January 10, 2004.
Wow.
And Leslie Noble, the firm of Hudak's other campaign manager.
Be seated, please. New question, the member from Temiskaming-Cochrane.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. In 2012, the government tried to kill the ONTC without any consultation, any planning, any policy, and it claimed that it would save the taxpayers of Ontario $265 million.
Shocking all.
What it didn't tell Ontarians was that the same budget this government allocated $325 million for divestment costs. And yesterday, the Auditor General's report outlined that the divestment goes ahead. It will cost the taxpayers of Ontario over $800 million. Will your government once and for all admit that it was wrong and announce the halt of the divestment of the ONTC?
Development in Mines.
Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Mr. Speaker, and my friend and colleague across the floor knows very well that the estimate of that large dollar figure is not an accurate reflection of our government's approach to transforming the ONTC. That is indeed an assessment of what the potential associated liability is. And may I say, the Auditor General says that himself. It assumes the worst.
Finish, please.
The Auditor General said this estimate assumes the worst-case scenario for a severance cost estimated and that no employees would be retained after divestment. Mr. Speaker, that is not our government's approach. We are very clear about how important the ONTC is in terms of an economic development agency in northeastern Ontario. That's why we are committed to a transformation of the ONTC. Our Minister's Advisory Committee has recognized that the status quo will not work. Everybody, I think, understands that status quo will not work, and that's why we're
supplementary.
Speaker, once again to the Premier, let's talk about this government's approach to the ONTC. They announced a divestment, yet in the Auditor General's report, they didn't even bother to crunch the numbers till 4 months after. Let's talk about this government's record on the ONTC. They're scrambling once again to come up with weasel words like transformation, and you know who's left out in the cold? Northerners, seniors, the people who use the train, the customers, small business, big business. The divestment is wrong and could leave Ontario with $820 million in costs for a train that no longer stops anywhere. Is this government still planning on spending $800 million to deny essential services to Northern Ontario? Premier, is that your real Ontario?
No. Minister?
Mr. Speaker, we are absolutely committed to seeing a sustainable, efficient, well-run Ontario Northland Transportation Committee. Right. And may I say, Mr. Speaker, the people, our members of our Ministerial Advisory Committee, are in agreement with us on that. I've got some extraordinarily important quotes. How about this from Mayor Al McDonald? We all agree, including the union, the management, the stakeholders, that the business model is broken and it needs to be restructured. The focus is on transformation, not divestment. Back in May, Mr. Speaker, at the Federation of Northern Ontario Municipalities annual general meeting, I publicly stated that divestment was no longer the only option on the table, and that's why we're working so hard to see the ONTC transform. It's got a bright future, Mr. Speaker. We make the right decisions. There are some tough decisions. We'd love to have your help in that regard as well, like all other people in Northern
Ontario. Answer. Your question, the member from York Southwestern.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Citizenship and Immigration. Mr. Speaker, in the last 3 years, $85 million in settlement funding to our province have been cut by the federal government. Settlement services play an important role in the life of newcomers as they adjust to a new life in Ontario and start making valuable contributions to our society. Federal cuts have changed the level of service that community agencies are able to provide for newcomers, and I have noticed the effects in my riding. Mr. Speaker, York Southwestern is home to thousands of newcomers, and among them, many Somali Canadians. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, can you inform the House on what kind of assistance your ministry is providing to help newcomers from the Somali community and the East African communities?
Mr. Citizenship and Immigration.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to thank the member for her question. Here in the province of Ontario, we believe in One Ontario. We believe that everyone in this province should have the opportunity to contribute, connect, and achieve their goals. And we also believe in investing in people through settlement services. Medenta Community Services and Community Action Resource Centre is located in the member's riding and provides services to more than 1,000 people of Somalian background. And Mr. Speaker, Medenta is one of the 8 settlement agencies in Ontario that are now receiving a grant to look at new and innovative ways to deliver settlement services to vulnerable immigrant populations and underserved communities. This organization's work focuses on the integration of Somali and Somali newcomers and youth. This year, Mr. Speaker, our government will invest $7.6 million into newcomer settlement services.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, for that response, and thank you to the minister. The settlement services that are provided to newcomers are life-changing. And while many new Canadians continue to choose Toronto as a destination, others are also choosing to settle in smaller communities across the province, communities like the Essex County, Sarnia, or the Niagara region. Newcomers that settle outside Toronto need access to the same services and programs provided in larger cities in order to participate fully in the economic, the social, and cultural life of our province. They need places that will provide them with services like language training and employment counseling. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, what newcomer settlement programs are available to newcomers across Ontario, more specifically to those who settle in smaller communities?
Thank you, Minister.
I'd like to thank the member again for her question. This year, our government will fund 98 community organizations across this great province to help 80,000 newcomers here in our province. Province-wide, 89% of clients surveyed last year reported that they can make more informed decisions about their new life in Ontario after receiving such services. And, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to highlight one of the organizations that provides newcomer services here in our province, and that's the Fort Erie Multicultural Centre. Since 2009, we have provided over half $1 million to this organization so they can deliver newcomer orientation sessions. Mr. Speaker, these important services are used by a broad range of clients, including permanent residents, refugee claimants, and provincial nominees. This government believes in helping newcomer settlement services and becoming a functioning part of what we do here in this province, because we know, Mr. Speaker, at the end of the day, when newcomers succeed, Ontario succeeds.
Question. The member from the Topical Lake Shore.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Government Services. As you know, this is my first term in the House, but I can tell you that a lot of people have asked me how things are going and what do you think of the management of the government. Well, I can tell you that I'm taken back. It's absolutely deplorable the things that have happened in this term of this legislature. I used to tell them at council that they could take a barrel of money and go down Bay Street and throw it in the lake, because that's what they were doing. Here you'd need a huge dump truck. You seem to have no idea of tax dollars and the value of them whatsoever. Mr. Minister, Service Ontario pays their employees an average of $145,000 a year, and they take off 25 days on average sick.
Question.
Now, what this means, Mr. Speaker, is that with you combined vacation days and statutory holiday.
Thank you. Thank you.
How about quiet? As I remind all members, when I stand, you sit. Minister of Government Services.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. We appreciated the Auditor General's report, and Mr. Speaker, I had a chance to meet with the Auditor General, where she congratulated me on the good work that Service Ontario has been doing. The Auditor General's report, Mr. Speaker, noted a number of areas for improvement. That's why we have the auditor. We accept those and we're moving forward, Mr. Speaker. The fact of the matter is, Mr. Speaker, that Service Ontario is a service, as it would suggest, which is across this province and which has been working over the past number of years to bring more private sector involvement.
Member from Durham will come to order.
To make sure that it offers efficient services to the people of Ontario.
Mr.
Speaker, I am pleased with the progress that we have been making. As I say, when I take a look at the Auditor General's report, she makes a number of suggestions that we will certainly be following up on.
Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, Service Ontario operates some of its facilities with private operators, and some of it's operated by the government. But according to the auditor's report, the cost of the government operations are almost three times what the private operator pays. Now, this again is another huge waste of money. You've got to remember the fact that we have a deficit of $12 billion. We've got a debt of $273 million. If we're ever going to get that reduced or eliminated, we've got to deal with things like this. We can't have this kind of overexpenditure and waste of money. And it's gone on far too long, and I want to know when the government's going to put a stop to it.
Thank you. Minister.
Rob Ford.
Mr. Speaker, as I said, we're very happy to follow up on what the Auditor General said. But, Mr. Speaker, the honourable member knows that there is a system of private sector offices in which handle high volumes, high transactions, and yes, we have some that are run by the government, Mr. Speaker, which are in small communities, offer a wide range of services, not all of them as popular and used as often, which causes for higher costs. And perhaps, Mr. Speaker, he wants to talk to some of his colleagues, because I sign letters all the time from his colleagues complaining about the fact that they don't have enough service, Ontario, in small rural communities. Mr. Speaker, we are trying to find a balance here between making sure that the people of Ontario can access these services in the communities, as well as finding efficiencies through an involvement with the private sector. Mr. Speaker, I think the honourable member should get his facts straight.
Thank you. Question, the member from Bramley, Gorham, Malton.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Mr. Speaker, in 2010, the government slashed statutory accident benefits. Those are the benefits that accident victims receive. By 50% across Ontario and 70% in the GTA. Now, in a report yesterday, the Auditor General confirmed that province-wide benefits were slashed by more than 50% in 2010, but added a new number. During the exact same time period when our benefits were slashed by more than 50%, our premiums went up by 8%. Our premiums went up by 8%. How does this government explain to the 7 million drivers in Ontario why 8% more has been taken out of their pockets at the same time that their benefits were slashed by 50%, all with the permission of this government?
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite knows fully well the cost of our premiums is something that our government has been addressing since 2003. We have taken measures. A number of our members have been advocating and leading the charge to find ways to reduce auto insurance premiums. It is why our government quickly took on the Auto Task Force to clamp down on fraud, Mr. Speaker. Some of the initiatives that the member is talking about is the increasing cost of claims that has to be addressed, and that's why we've brought forward legislation in cooperation with the member opposite to ensure that we get those costs down and get those premiums down as well, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, the reality is that in 2010, $2 billion have been saved by the insurance industry. $2 billion of savings, of which the people of Ontario have not even seen a penny of savings in terms of their premiums. The Auditor General made it very, very clear that there's been an 8% increase in premiums at the same time when costs went down by 50% when it comes to the benefits that we've received. Drivers are getting frustrated with broken promises. When will this government actually do something to bring down premiums, to give some relief to the 7 million drivers in Ontario?
Minister of Finance.
Let's be clear, Mr. Speaker. Ontario has some of the most comprehensive benefits anywhere in Canada. We have been taking extraordinary measures to support and help our drivers and those that are affected during these accidents. But more importantly, it has also been very clear that these rising costs have affected our premiums, and it's why they are too high. And it's why we've taken the necessary steps to clamp down and get them reduced. And they started to reduce, Mr. Speaker. We have competitors right throughout the system that are now advertising lower rates. The strategy is working. We are bringing down those rates, and we're doing everything that we can to protect those drivers. And at times we do so without support from the opposition, and that, Mr. Speaker, is shameful.
Thank you. Question, the member from Mississauga East Brooksville.
Thank you, Speaker, and my question is for the Minister responsible for Seniors Affairs. Speaker, there's a very important statistic I'd like to share. In Peel, in the year 2017, there will be more people over the age of 65 than children under the age of 14. Think about that. More people over the age of 65 than children under the age of 14 in 3 years. So I really laud and applaud this minister responsible for seniors affairs for showing such leadership on this file. And as the constituents in my riding age, Speaker, the fact is many of them do approach me and ask me for advice on the various options when it comes to the issue of long-term care versus retirement facilities. And they're looking for some information, valuable information, that will help them make that decision. So, Speaker, through you to the Minister, my question is, what kind of information is out there that could help my constituents make this decision?
Thank you, Minister responsible for seniors.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I'm very grateful to the member from Mississauga East Cookeville for this wonderful question. And I believe she's not the only one with members, seniors looking for accommodation and the proper accommodation. I think every member, Speaker, has that particular problem. Let me say, in Ontario, Speaker, we have some 700 retirement homes with some 55,000 residents, and every home, Speaker, offers different levels of care. They have the option and the choice where and how to live, Speaker. Also, through the Ontario Retirement Home Act Regulatory Authority, we provide all kinds of information to anyone, seniors or family members, that wish to
look
into the aspect of a particular retirement home, Speaker. We provide the information on the web, through the seniors info line. We have the seniors line as well, and we provide that information on several
levels.
Speaker, I thank the minister for that answer. Thank you so much. Speaker, once families have made that decision, what they're really looking for is peace of mind that their loved ones are safe. So I'm wondering if the minister could respond and just tell me and my constituents what we are doing to make sure, what kind of oversight is there, especially when it comes to licensing. Who is issuing these licenses and what action is taken if trouble is noticed? Thank you.
Minister.
Speaker, again, I have to thank the member for a good question. I think this is a concern that every member of the House has when they have to look at a particular home and how do they view and how they assess that particular house and where to put their loved one, Speaker. It is the information that we provide, and it is also the safety that we provide for the seniors when they look for a particular home, Speaker. To the Retirement Home Act and the Regulatory Authority, Speaker, we provide all the necessary information so seniors and families can make a choice, what they want to do, where they want to live, and how they want to live, Speaker. Also, Speaker, let me say that every resident is notified when a house may be in difficulty, Speaker. We don't rest on our laurels, if you will, but we take immediate action. We notify the local authorities, the CCAs, the LINs, the local health network, Speaker, the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Housing, and make sure that the housing fits to the needs of that particular senior.
Your question, the member from Nipissing.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Premier, yesterday the Auditor General confirmed what we've told you from day one. There would be no savings from your fire sale of Ontario Northland. In fact, as you now know, instead of saving $265 million, the auditor dropped a bombshell. It will cost you $820 million. Now, that's a difference of $1 billion. When we first disclosed that you knew this last summer, you changed your tune. You then said, quote, "Divestment isn't the only answer." But it was only after you saw the draft of the auditor's report 2 weeks ago that you came up with a new phrase, transformation. Premier, why is it that you only change your direction in Ontario Northland after you get caught?
Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Is it parliamentary to say that's malarkey? The member knows very well that last May at Fanon's AGM, after a couple of months working with the the Premier on this plan, we made a determination that divestment was not the only option. So we moved into the transformation phase of our approach to the ONGC, where we're determined to find a sustainable long-term future. And of course, we're absolutely committed to making that happen. And the fact is, the member also knows very clearly that the figures that are cited are actual total potential associated liabilities. Again, the approach that does not reflect the direction that we're going in. We are going to come up with some very good decisions, we believe. The Ministerial Advisory Committee is working well together. Mayor Al McDonald is on that. President Alan Spatchin, industry leaders, First Nation, Métis Nation leaders. We are determined to see a long-term, sustainable future for the ONGC, and we're doing some great work.
Thank you. Stop the clock, please. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Order. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. I think what Malarkey is trying to weasel out of $820 million. Let's look at the facts. The Freedom of Information showed us your goal was to divest Ontario Northland, and if that failed, liquidate. Pennies on the dollars. Through the gas plant scandal documents, we learned there would be no savings. Instead, there would be a $1 billion hole in your budget, and it was only then that you began trotting out these weasel words. But the auditor told us
you knew in July 2012. The member will withdraw.
I withdraw. Wiggle words is what I meant to say. I actually.
Let's just continue. With no other editorial, please.
For 18 months, Speaker, this government has continued to leave, as the auditor said, uncertainty in the marketplace. You left 1,000 families in the north unable to make key purchases or life decisions. Premier, how can you be so heartless to northerners? Will you do as we've asked in letter after letter to you and stop the divestment today?
Minister.
You know, Mr. Speaker, I think the member from Nipissing just might want to get off his high horse. Northerners have not forgotten, Mr. Speaker, that it was his party when they were in government that tried to sell off the ONGC. And the member from Nipissing himself has said some pretty amazing things publicly. How about this, what he said to the ONGC workers who were gathered outside his office? I'm going to be straight with you. I've always been straight with you, said the member from Nipissing. I can't tell you what you want to hear. I can't say I'm opposed to privatization. So these guys, we are determined to move forward for a sustainable long-term Ontario Northland transformation.
New question. The member from London West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, yesterday members of this House learned that more than 500 workers at the London Kellogg's plant are losing their jobs. As the Premier knows, these are good-paying jobs, family-supporting jobs, the kind of jobs that generate tax revenues, that pay for the kids, the mortgage, the car, and all the other expenses of daily life. Workers at Kellogg's are devastated by this news and understandably angry when they see their plant shutting down. What they want to know, what my community wants to know, is did this government take any action at all to prevent the closure of the Kellogg plant and protect good jobs in London?
Thank you, Premier.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question being asked, and I understand the anger and frustration of the employees and the community in London over this decision, a very regrettable business decision, and of course, the worst part, I think, is the timing of it so close before the holiday season. And so our number one concern as a government and mine as the minister responsible is for the employees that unfortunately received this very bad news about the closure, upcoming closure over the course of the next year. And so, in fact, we've reached out to the community. I spoke with the Mayor of London actually just several minutes ago prior to question period to offer my support so we can make sure that we're providing every support. The Ministry of Training, Colleges and Universities, as well as providing through their usual supports all facilities,
answer,
all supports available to support the employees and their families and the communities at this very difficult time.
Thank you. Supplementary, the member from London Fanshawe.
Premier, too many companies are shutting down in southwestern Ontario. In the last several weeks, we have lost more than 1,000 manufacturing jobs under this government's watch. The Premier said she expected these closures. She said it would be unrealistic not to have these closures and some negative impact. Now in London, more than 500 families will be losing their jobs. This will have a devastating impact in our local economy and in our community. What is the Premier's plan to stop the jobs from bleeding away from southwestern Ontario?
Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I want to say that last month the job numbers recently came out, and they demonstrated that last month alone we created more than 12,000 jobs in manufacturing alone, many of those in southwestern Ontario. And I want to also reiterate that there are important investments that are happening in London, in the London area. And I want to indicate that the unemployment rate in London, fortunately, where we saw it back in March, Mr. Speaker, the unemployment rate was more than 9%. It's come down in the last month to 7.5%, and that's a very important development. And in fact, over the last year in London, 3,000 new manufacturing jobs, according to Statistics Canada, have been created in London, in the London area alone. So we are making progress. It is a very difficult time, and I don't want to underestimate the particular importance and the very great disappointment I have in this government personally for the developments at Kellogg's. That's never good news for anybody or their families or a community is important to London, and I'm certainly going to work hard in the months ahead.
Thank you.
See what we can do further.
Question, the member from Ajax Pickering.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport. Speaker, in October, the Minister, the Premier and myself announced in my riding of Ajax Pickering a $3.5 million fund for the expansion of our province's world-class trail systems as part of the Pan Am Games Legacy Fund. Several organizations such as TransCanada Trail, Share the Road Coalition and the Ontario Trails Council praised our government's commitment and support for Ontario Trails. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, could he please explain why this Pan Am Games Legacy funding is so important, not only to the people in my riding of Ajax Pickering, but to all of Ontario?
Excellent. Thank you, Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport.
To thank the member from Ajax Pickering for asking the question, Speaker. Linking the Pan American Games to expand our world-class trail system is, in my opinion, a smart thing to do. Speaker, this will help complete 250 kilometers in gaps in Ontario's Trans-Canada Trail. It will connect communities from Ottawa to Windsor, Fort Erie to Huntsville, creating a continuous trail for more than 2,000 kilometers. Speaker, investing in infrastructure for the 2015 Pan American Games is part of Ontario government's three-part plan to grow our economy. Invest in people, invest in infrastructure, and creating a welcoming business environment. Speaker, investment related to the game will create 26,000 jobs.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Supplementary.
Thank you for that response, Minister. With the Ajax Sportsplex ballpark also being built in my riding, the Pan-Parapan American Games is certainly bringing in many benefits and opportunities to Durham Region and the entire province. I know that the people I represent and those across Ontario will utilize these trails for years to come. The extensions will ensure our communities of Ajax and Pickering are connected like never before.
They will get to enjoy year-round hiking, trails, trout fishing, and picnic and recreation opportunities. However, this cannot be the only opportunity our government has taken to support Ontario's trail systems, is it? Mr. Speaker, through you again to the Minister, can he please tell us what else our government has been doing to support our province's trails? Thank you.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, in 2005, we launched the Ontario Trail Strategy. It guides the development, management, promotion, and use of trails in Ontario. Since 2005, Speaker, we have established the Ontario Trails Coordinating Committee to oversee implementation of the strategy. Map 2,466 trailheads representing over 38,000 kilometers of trail and 10,000 trail segments across the province. Speaker, we also funded a variety of local and regional trail projects to improve accessibility for people with disabilities and develop an award-winning central website for trails. Speaker,
answer.
Since 2009, the province has invested more than $77 million to support Ontario's trails, and we are seeing tremendous results. Thank you, Speaker.
Question, the member from Cambridge.
Hey, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Education. An audit at the Toronto District School Board released yesterday was a crystal clear demonstration that your so-called wage freeze isn't a wage freeze at all. Our leader, Tim Hudakis, stood in this legislature day in and day out and asked for an across-the-board public sector wage freeze. The idea was dismissed because your government was adamant that it already had one. When board members, without approval, decide to give themselves a salary increase, that's not a wage freeze. In fact, TDSB officials told auditors other school boards have also ignored the order to freeze pay. This is the problem, Minister. When your wage freeze isn't a real wage freeze, no one takes you seriously and everyone feels entitled to grab whatever they want. But it's not too late. Will you adopt the Ontario PC plan to adopt an across-the-board public sector wage freeze to rein in spending and stop the foolishness at the TDSB?
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much. And obviously, the report from Ernst & Young, which was released yesterday, did raise a number of areas of concern. I think it's important to recognize that the new director and the audit committee from TDSB are the people who asked for the forensic audit, and that they have responded that they will, in fact, work with us to make sure that all of the recommendations are addressed. But what I must point out in this particular case is that my ministry officials did tell any school board that checked in with the ministry and made it very clear that the broader Public Sector Compensation Act did apply to the senior administration. So it was very clear to everybody involved that the act
Thank you.
Minister, it's clear you buried the report on the same day as the Auditor General's report in an attempt to pull the wool over the eyes of the media and Ontario taxpayers. On its own, the rules don't apply to me attitude at the TDSB is bad enough. But this is a culture of entitlement, and you have refused to do anything about it. This is the same TDSB where workers billed $143 to screw at a pencil sharpener, where workers billed $266 for 7 hours of work to hang three pictures on a wall. It's no wonder that the audit found that 79% of the transactions in the director's office did not use a competitive bidding process. Monitoring the situation is no longer enough, Minister. Ontarians expect action. Will you show some leadership and make these board members pay back the salary increases they should never have had in the first place? Will taxpayers get their Christmas refund, Minister?
Be seated, please. Thank you, Minister of Education.
Thank you very much. And could we just please sort out here what we're talking about? We are not talking about board members whose salary was not in compliance. We are talking about the members of the senior executive whose salaries are not in compliance. Now, that is very, very serious, Speaker. And I will have demanded, that the board will come into compliance with the broader Public Sector Compensation Act. that. They will come into full compliance, as will any other board. In fact, I have. We do a number of spot audits on school boards throughout the province every year, and I have asked my officials to add an
Answer.
Audit of senior executive compensation to the boards that they are doing a spot audit on currently.
Thank you. New question. Hamilton Mountain.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Speaker, yesterday's Auditor General's report provided us with the facts and figures to back up what families have been telling us for some time, that lengthy delays for diagnosis and treatment for children with autism mean that young people are not being given their best chance to succeed. And even when they get off the multi-year wait list, access to service remains uneven and arbitrary. Families have long been telling this government that the systems for supports for children with autism is failing. Today, there are more children waiting for services than those that are receiving them. And we know that children who would often benefit the most from a particular therapy are simply not eligible. To make matters worse, the auditor tells us that this government has failed to collect information, assess program effectiveness, and measures for the outcome.
Thank you.
Speaker, at what point is the government
Thank you.
Going to take
Premier.
Thank you, and thank you for the question. And I'd like to thank the Auditor General for her report and the discussions that we've had with respect to the recommendations. We welcome her input in terms of how we can further improve our services. But, Speaker, let me remind this House what this government and this party has done with respect to autism. One is we have quadrupled the funding that's available for autism services. We eliminated the age 6 cutoff for services, ensuring that services are available for children up to the age of 18, not only up to the age of 6, which is where it was at prior to us taking it to government. We will continue to increase our investments. We invested an additional $5 million. And as well, we have a clinical expert committee that is going to be bringing forward recommendations with respect to changes that we need to make with respect to autism. We will continue to work with our communities.
Thank you. The point of order for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Speaker. I would like to welcome Katie Stewart here from my constituency office in London.
Yeah. Thank you. The member from the Tropical Lakeshore on a point of order.
I'd just like to correct the record. Apparently, I said that the debt was $273 million. Of course, it's $273
billion. Member from Timmins, James Bay, on point of order.
Thank you, Speaker. I'm seeking unanimous consent to move a motion in regard to extend the sitting of the House to Monday, December 16th.
The member from Timmins, James Bay, is seeking unanimous consent to move a motion. Without notice, do we agree?
No.
I heard a no. There are no deferred votes. This House stands adjourned until 3 p.m. this afternoon.